is Sociology 315, Sociology of Work. Today we're going to talk about workers with younger children. That's our focus today. When we hear workers with younger children, there are a lot of unique challenges and numerous demands that they face. Things like time, spending quality time with children and family, things like energy, to work a 9-to-5, and even part-time still have the energy that you need to appropriately care for your family and help them grow appropriately. Issues of constant care in the sense of you have to constantly care for your family, you have to constantly check and ensure that they're receiving the things that they need and the appropriate services and support from you. And supervision of children is a really important issue, especially in this day and age when we see a lot of harm that can come to children. And also illness, when our kids are sick, how do we continue to support them, especially with issues of daycare and surrounding that. So I want to, first of all, mention that we're talking about workers with younger children, but when we talk about support that work environments provide, it really extends beyond workers with younger children. It really speaks to support that jobs provide to support families or individuals that work for them. So I want to talk about our discussion topic or question that you can participate in today. And that discussion question is, how does your job support you in caring for your children, your family, and with everyday life issues? Are there certain things that your job provides, certain perks or benefits? Certain things that your individual work environment just simply has adopted or just decided to do to be able to support you with your family or you with everyday issues of stress or the other responsibilities that you have in everyday life. So talk to me about that, whether you're working full-time or part-time and the other challenges that go along with that, family, young children, relationships, as well as not going to school full and part-time as well. I want to start off by talking about a little bit of the different types of studies and research that goes into looking at issues that face families with young children and families in general. A lot of the information and statistics I'll be talking about today come from a variety of different types of sources. For example, we've got the National Child Care Survey. We've also got the National Study of the Changing Workforce, and also various surveys from United States companies that have just sought to look at the individual issues that many other companies may be facing and efforts to improve them. Now, looking at some of the findings, generally male and female employees say that they experience a great deal of stress being able to just simply balance work and family responsibility. It's a big job. It's one of the biggest issues affecting the workplace, not necessarily the stress and pressure of the job, and you need that, but how do you marry the stress and pressure with family and go on the work environment, focus on your job, and then maybe not worry about family? It's not always as easy as it sounds. So we know the stress is home. Stress at home is going to follow you to work. It affects the quality of work. It affects your production, your interaction with customers, and also other employees. And, after looking at the quality of home life, your quality of home life also bleeds into your work environment. So they go hand in hand. So it's really important to have a job atmosphere and environment that is very supportive, even in just everyday life issues and stress. Now, a big issue, the care of children while parents are at work. It remains a critical concern for parents. Primarily, their children, of course. And then also we hear every day more stories and concerns and issues about child abuse and neglect and the lack of supervision and care that children are supposed to have in these outside situations of care, daycares, family, home cares, different schools. So it is a big concern. Now, 24.7% of parents can worry about their children while they're at work, almost or most of the time. So it's a large concern, and it doesn't end when you just drop your child off or you leave that child in care, wherever you leave them in care, and then you go to work and you're in another world. You also worry about your children. Are they safe? Are they in good care and in good company? is there adequate supervision? Are you going to make sure that my child is safe and free from harm? What if your child is ill? We've got a whole other level of situations if your child is ill. Are they being educated and socialized in an appropriate way and manner the same way that you might do if you have the opportunity to stay home and play a part in that? Luna says, I don't have children yet, and I don't work for a company that offers any benefits for families. We're less than 50 employees. Can you talk about small companies offering services for employees and their families? Yeah, Luna, that is something we are going to touch on, because many of our governmental programs, in order to be able to provide that for employees, have to have a minimum number of employees on site, which is 50. That's the minimum number of employees. When we look at smaller companies, what we're primarily looking at are the companies individually on their own have come up with different types of strategies, different types of services and resources to be able to support their employees. So in many cases, sometimes it's left to the creativity of that individual employee to support their employers, to support their employees if they're not using some of our governmental types of programs. So we'll talk about that. We'll touch on that as well. Now, the idea of the whole child care situation is that 41% of parents brought their children to work during work hours at some given point of time. Half of these say it occurred more than once a year. The National Study of the Changing Workforce research found, while looking at issues of maternity leave and other family support, that a third of parents didn't have the option of taking time off for childbirth or parenting. So, because of this, many parents express a willingness to be able to trade things like their salary or other benefits to actually have that choice. You have to have a specific amount of time that is specifically dedicated to child care, childbirth, maternity leave. It's something that, meaning paternity leave, we have those laws available now. We'll talk more about those as we talk about the Family Leave Act. But they're very specific in programs like that. It may not be paid leave, so you're looking to take time off and you're not going to be compensated for that time. But it is something that is a necessity in our society, and it should be, you know, something that a parent wants to do, but some feel as though they can't take the time off because financially they cannot support the family. Now, those being used under the study, they looked at 405 dual-earner parents of young children. So 405 families where mom and dad were both working. What they found was that 1 out of 3 parents of infants or toddlers and 1 out of 4 parents had a difficult time finding child care. Difficult time in the sense of, first of all, locating child care. Locating quality child care. Nowadays, we can drive up and down any city street or area and see, you know, family daycare or daycare center, child care. But is it quality child care? Are we going to feel confident and secure when we drop our children off there? Also, cost. Cost is a big issue and situation, the cost of child care. It's almost, if we look at the cost of child care, some parents say, you know what, that's all almost another entire job for me just to pay for the cost of child care. There's some parents who say, you know, because of child care issues, it's going to cost us more to pay in child care than it would if I just stay home and watch my child and care for my child myself. And then also, you know, flexible time, right? There are flexible times within child care because parents don't always work 9 to 5. Sometimes they, you know, may work a little earlier or they may work some extended hours. So are there flexible options that are also going to be offered there? Now, when we look at child care, sometimes there are unexpected crises in child care. So even if you've secured child care, you're not home free, so to speak. The child care situation can break down. How can it break down? Well, children become ill because of state licensing regulations. You cannot bring an ill or sick child to a child care or daycare facility because you run the risk of infecting or exposing other children to the illness. And so what happens is you who are faced with a situation where, okay, I've got child care, and it's probably some great child care, but my child is sick, I can't bring them in. And so what has to happen is somebody's got to stay home. I've also mentioned the idea of extended hours. You know, extended hours, you work late, but you have to pick your child up at a certain time. Also, child cares deal with routine closures. There are reasons why child care is not always going to be open at the designated hours that they have told you about. It can be situations of holidays, of course. You only work during the holiday, but that child care or daycare facility or center is closed for national holidays or closed for designated days to commemorate certain things. Maybe they're doing staff development training, or maybe they're doing a thorough clean, or they're having some sort of work done to make the place safer. Some have summer hours. They may change or adjust the hours. Or maybe the provider just needs to take a break, or they've given, you know, some time off, so they're on vacation. So there are some times when the child care system is going to break down. And as parents, you have to figure out, okay, hopefully I know these situations ahead of time. And some situations I don't know, and then it causes you to have to, you know, come together and figure out how you're going to handle it. Now, also the National Child Care Survey found that of approximately 2,300 mothers studied, 15% lost time from work during the previous month due to failure in their regular child care arrangements for a lot of the reasons I just talked about. So we're looking at mothers who are losing time from work, and fathers too. But looking at these mothers, illness, child care closures, different types of things, and a fourth of them report 2 to 5 breakdowns in child care arrangements in the previous 3 months. So this is something that is reoccurring. These are situations that are sometimes out of our control, and because of that, they cause stress and turmoil. And how do jobs and workplaces support people in this situation? So when you get breakdowns, easily defined as things like it's going to cause you to have to come to work late, or you're going to have to leave early, or you just simply cannot attend work at all on that particular given day. So that focuses our breakdowns. And we've also got some special needs relating to parenting, responsibilities. We've got 5 categories. I'm going to briefly list them, and then we'll break them down and talk about them individually. First, we have financial assistance. When we get financial assistance, we're talking about daycare costs. Next, there's time off from work for family issues. The third is programs and services. We're looking at programs and services that are available on your job to be able to assist you with family matters. The policies, what kinds of policies exist within job places, about how they support their families. And also community programs. How does the community come together to be able to support families and workers and employees so that they have a situation that is more compatible and workable for them? So we're going to start with financial assistance. When we look at financial assistance, the federal government does provide several tax incentives related to daycare. So there is some support there. Individuals who pay for daycare expenses for their children, they can be eligible for certain things. And so they can be eligible for a tax credit for up to $3,000 for one dependent, or up to $6,000 for 2 or more dependents. Also, we've got workplaces and daycare, issues of what we call capital expenditures for construction or furnishing of daycare centers. So what that is their job, or employers or corporations that can receive some funds and support assistance to be able to construct and build their own daycare that is directly attached to their job site. Or also they can connect with other daycare centers to be able to provide some different slots of support to their employees for daycare centers. So what if, you know, your situation is daycare, and what if there was a child center or daycare center on your job? That's an awesome thing, because it can alleviate a lot of stress and pressure that you normally feel if your child is away from you. music would lessen your stress, would ease your concerns about your children, and enable you to really focus on your work, or to know that you can get your child the best of walking across the parking lot or to the next level, or the next floor, or even a block or two away. Let's look at the idea of child care, and is it a solution to workplace absenteeism? Is that something that can actually support? Now, according to the Department of Labor, 72% of workplace absenteeism is due to child care related issues. So, you know, private industries are looking to come up with some different solutions. Let's take a look at that.
Labor, 72% of workplace absenteeism is due to child care related issues. Once again, here's Quinn Tran with a look at how private industry is coming up with some solutions.
Known as the CMNLES, Durant sits in South Central Oklahoma. It's a small community that understands the value of partnerships in early childhood education. This Head Start program serves children in the community. It's supported by the Child Foundation and is part of the Smart to Start Coalition, an organization that puts children first.
We can't be there their entire lives, but we can give them what they call a head start in a life. A lot of these children come from low-income families and would not be able to experience the opportunity that Head Start provides for them.
The opportunities include access to technology, the development of cognitive and social skills, creativity, and play. Business leaders like John Massey believe a financial commitment to early childhood education is a sound investment.
All kids will do it in the and they will learn. You do need to get smart. Because the ordinary thing is you always need smart. What we're doing today is building our workforce 20 years from now.
Ray Beachy is the president of Oklahoma City Educare. This Educare facility is the first to open in Oklahoma City, made possible by philanthropic and community support. The Educare program is a model for quality child care and early childhood education that features small class sizes, degree teachers, and an outcome-based curriculum.
We as a people should be willing to invest whatever it takes to bring that level of care up to that standard. I mean, it's our future. One of the things that we will not do in Educare is that we will not raise these kids for a family. You cannot drop your child at the door and leave. You must also be willing to make an investment in the development of your children.
So we're looking at programs that are providing support for families and caring for their children, and caregivers of the community are really important. You know, for the community or people within the community, employers to kind of partner together and say, you know, providing care or an atmosphere where we feel is healthy, and providing positive socialization for our young people, and not only eases the stress and physical strain felt by employees, but it's also an investment in our future. After all, these young people who were fighting for the appropriate child care now are the same people who are going to be in the job force, you know, years later. And so should we provide them with an appropriate atmosphere for their young and be partners in supporting each other in that. We've also got federal programs where employees can receive up to $5,000 worth of daycare from their employer without paying tax on it. So it's putting aside $5,000 of your earnings that is tax-free. And so tax is not being taken out of it. It's being put aside so you can use this money for daycare expenses. Employing a nurse to pay your daycare expenses, as long as you have documentation that you have paid the daycare expenses and that's what it's meant to, then you can utilize this money, reimburse this amount of tax-free money to people paying the cost. Also, what's connected to that is documentation that the daycare is available to high and low-income employees, which is really important too, because not all employees can afford high-cost daycares. support that we have is called Abandoned Care Assistance Programs, or what we call flexible spending accounts. So a recent survey of 178 companies found that relatively few offer financial aid or assistance with child care needs, maybe for a variety of reasons, maybe simply could not afford to, or they didn't really see it as a priority. Now, DCAP, Dependent Care Assistance Programs, they enable employees to set aside tax-free portions of their income for dependent care through payroll deductions. Now, 20% of companies surveyed, they offer this option. So the employee pays daycare, this can improve the reimbursement comes there as well. Now, there are advantages for employers who use these types of services or these types of support. First of all, they're not required to pay Social Security or unemployment tax on the income that you're setting aside or using. So that's beneficial for them. But there are also disadvantages for parents. If you're going to put aside a certain amount of funds, then first of all, it requires careful planning. Careful planning in the sense of, which daycare or school or atmosphere are you placing your child in, and are you making sure that the costs are not going to exceed the amount you have set aside. Also, the unused portion is forfeited at the end of the year. So that's another concern to look at. Can be transferred to the next year. And using this, the DCAP, it disqualifies parents from the claiming the income tax credit for child care. So it's kind of a swap or switch that you use to determine which one is actually right for you. We also have what we call daycare slots, sometimes we have discounts, subsidies, or even vouchers. And how that works is that a company can purchase a child care slot in a company. They don't necessarily have to, there's no minimum amount of employees in a company that says, I just want to be after I want to help. They can purchase child care slots from existing child cares for their employees because you may find a really great child care or daycare facility is full, or there's a waiting list. But now there are employees and companies who are going into these programs that are close by, their quality programs, getting good ratings, and they're saying, hey, I'd like to purchase these slots, so available slots so that my employees can access this daycare. It's close by, it can relieve stress and strain and pressure on them. And a portion of this cost is actually tax deductible business expense. And also some companies are even negotiating discounts. They're going to negotiate discounts with childcare for employees. Look, they're providing assistance and service to the daycares. They're saying, hey, I'm going to guarantee that you've got some slots filled because my employees are needing it. At the same time, there's support for that employee saying, look, I know that some of you are dropping your kids off, miles and miles away, and you're feeling stressed because you can't get to them in time or other situations. Well, here's a daycare. Here's an appropriate quality place where you can put your child close by and nearby. Now, there are the governmental programs that companies can access by law. The employees have access to many of those. But there are also things that companies are utilizing that could be independent of that or just on their own, or maybe the specific designation of having 50 employees to be able to take advantage of this particular program is not there. So there are other things, the special incentives that large employers and small employers are actually using. For an order company, they cover 80% of the cost for a caregiver who is caring for an ill child at home. Hughes Electrics, they subsidize in-home child care for mildly ill children, and they give reimbursement for daycare during work or travel. We'll also mention a few more as well. But when we talk about time off, an issue of time when we're looking at parents and caring for families, leave and time off from work is an important situation. The Family Medical Leave Act, FMLA, established in 1993 with the Clinton administration, is an important added thing that we have been able to benefit from. It, first of all, ensures workers' jobs are safe while they take up to 12 weeks of leave. Now, the thing is, that sounds great. That's a wonderful support. Now, it's 12 weeks of unpaid leave, so you're going to have to make adjustments. So it can be for you to take care of a sick child. It can also be to bond or to bond with a newborn or with an adoptive child, which is unique. And the coverage is expanded. There are different definitions, so those definitions continue to change as you see the need for this next program. There's also, it's been extended to families and people in the military. We know that their situations are unique. You have families in the military dealing with deployment. Their family members are having to go to other locations and places during wartime for different types of things, and they're getting away from the family. That's also a situation that takes careful planning as a family to look at daycare expenses, to look at basic economic situations and be able to pay for certain things or to rearrange in terms of supervision to emotionally get children ready for that. You know, a parent being gone, and especially in situations with the military, unfortunately, some possibilities of a parent may be coming back injured, or unfortunately, some parents may not come back at all. And so these are services that are provided there to support families in the unique situation of the military. Now, as I said before, the Family Medical Leave Act, a great act to access, but it does not provide paid leave. So you can take the available time off, but it's not paid time off. So it does require families to be able to have to shift and rearrange or even to ultimately decide, you know, can we, you know, access this or not. This is something that, you know, all employers are mandated to be able to provide. So there's not a minimum amount of employees that they have to have. This is an accessible type of program available from government to employees. Now, some companies offer personal time off plans. So they have a more flexible use in use of paid leave. So the U.S. Office of Personnel Management has actually some new rules when it comes to the formal employees' use of 13 days of sick leave. So generally, have 13 days of sick leave. You can use 5 of those days for children and family members to care for a sick child or a family member. Now, of course, definitions are expanded to include spouses, their parents, siblings, and even sibling spouses. So we're expanding the definition because we know, even though the individual family members in our home are, you know, who we're caring for, that care and support that we provide to extended family members is just as important to the care that we provide for our immediate family members. And so, as a society, we're recognizing that because these are also issues that provide stress in the workplace. Now, continuing to look at time, there was a study that was done, and what they find is that 30% of families require more than 2 weeks of sick, 2 weeks of care to care for sick children or elderly relatives. And the unfortunate part about that is that 20% of families work in jobs where there's no paid sick leave. So it requires them to take time off without pay, putting them in difficult financial situations, or to have to figure out how they're going to juggle it. Now, let's take a closer look at the Family Medical Leave Act and what it provides, looking at legal facts and information.
And the two of you want to know, can she take time off from her job? And if she does, is she going to get paid for it? Is she going to have a job when she comes back? Or exactly what's going on? You've heard something about a federal law that protects her job, but you're just not sure what's involved. Hello, I'm Robert Todd, and I'm here to answer the question, what is the Family Medical Leave Act, oftentimes abbreviated FMLA? Well, first of all, this is a federal law that went into effect in 1993 during the Clinton administration, and it is a very comprehensive law, and while it applies to most governmental agencies, with respect to private enterprises, there is a requisite number of employees, approximately 50, and there are other requirements. It's not automatic that everyone that employs anyone in the United States is subject to this act.
does, if you are covered by the Act, it does allow you to take up to 12 weeks of unpaid leave and does guarantee your job, but there are certain requirements. If you have specific questions, you may want to go on the United States Department of Labor website, pull up the FMLA, and take a look at it. There's a section under the Act entitled Frequently Asked Questions that will probably answer most of your questions. I'm Robert Todd, and thank you for watching.
Okay, so that's the Family Medical Leave Act. I do want to provide a correction. This is a program where there is a minimum amount of employees required to be able to take advantage of it. There are also part-time work options. Some families look at, well, you know, full-time work is something that I'm not able to do because I have a lot of responsibilities caring for the family. So part-time work options with full or maybe prorated benefits. There are part-time work options after birth, which can provide a new mother to be able to take that time off, but then phase back into full-time work after that maternity leave, because you know, you're still bonding and attaching and connecting with your child. You're still getting back, you know, physically to where you need to be, trying to ease into this new routine, especially if this is your first child or an additional child. And so, you know, being able to have that option of phasing back from part-time to full-time is definitely support for you as an individual or a family. Now, with the different types of options available, the studies do show that two-thirds of women choose an option that can accommodate work and family. So the advantages here are flexibility in terms of looking at some part-time options. If it is flexible, you can make it work. The disadvantage when you look at part-time work, of course, lower wages, reduced benefits. You know, there are many jobs where there are no benefits for part-time work. You know, you're very lucky if you can find a series of, you know, substantial benefits for working somewhere part-time. And then also limited opportunities for advancement. Many times part-time workers may not be looked at in the same light that full-time workers are. You're literally not there as many hours during the day, which can lower the instances of you interacting with your supervisor or key professionals, or to literally put your mark on that job. And some people will put you kind of on this mommy track. Well, you know, she's going to have a child, and, you know, that's going to be her priority. I don't really see her moving into the company or have anything her interests. And he says that this is one of the perks of working in education. We have personal leave days that can be used for anything pertaining to health, education, dependents, education too, doctor appointments, etc. I've heard that FMLA guarantees you have a job when you go back to work, but it does not guarantee that it is the same job. Is this true? That I don't know. I think it would be a great thing to say that, you know, here's the time that I'm allotted to take off, and to be able to feel secure and know that I'm taking this time off for the good of my family and myself. And to know that your job is secure when you come back is an awesome thing. I don't know if that guarantee is also saying that, okay, that job may not be the original job you left, but it is still a job. I don't know the specifics. That would be good to find the specifics of that. Yeah, and sometimes you find in different fields there are different types of unique benefits. He mentioned the field of education. I myself, before I went into the field of education, I worked in the field of social work for many years. And what we look at there, just simply because of the nature of the job and the increased stress level, you know, making sure that children are safe, cared for, dealing with issues of abuse and neglect, and how stressful that can truly be on an employee. We are also allowed to use, you know, when you come into the job, you have your sick time, you have vacation time, and we also have our personal time. But the thing is, if you've used up any one or bitten part and piece of it, you can simply use it for whatever you want to designate it for. You know, we're always encouraged to take some sort of what we would call mental health day, you know, at least once a month, because you want to make sure that emotionally this job is not draining you. And oftentimes when we see in that field, you know, while we're busy, you know, making sure that everybody else's job is safe, we need to make sure that ours is safe. So it was just a general thing in that field that we needed to take time and that they were going to provide as much support as possible, knowing that your job is there and to support you as well. And with part-time options, not just women, they're working part-time too. You know, families are looking at it together, or people individually are looking at it. What's more feasible for me? What is more family friendly? Or how is this equation of work and family and that balance in that working? There's another dynamic, some of you may have heard of, is the income common. Again, I was able to do this at one point. The idea of job sharing. What happens if you have two people who are literally sharing the same job, but each are working part-time hours? And so it's an interesting type of situation. Different companies and organizations may offer this job, offer this type of option. That might be how the job is listed, or it might be a situation where the job exists as a full-time option, and they're willing to split it to part-time options just to get the position filled. While going to college, finding a job sometimes was difficult, but the necessity to have a job, even though we're going to school full-time, was something we really needed to make sure that happened. We had to survive and pay for our everyday needs. In looking for a job, we found a full-time job for a secretary. And my friend and I said, well, it's 9-to-5. We can't do 9-to-5. Well, what if we go and talk to them and say, you know what, I have classes in the afternoon and evening, so what if I split into the morning? And you've got classes in the morning, what if you just split your day in the evening? So we went to the employer, and we actually talked to them about it. We're students, we've got to work, it's a necessity for us, but we're going to school too. Are you open to this? And the employer was actually open to this, and this was something that we did. Now, the agreement was, of course, he really did need a full-time person, and he said, well, you know what, I don't have a full-time person now, but I need the job filled. Stuff that needs to get done here. I'll take you girls on until I can find a full-time employee, and that's what happened. So it's becoming common, especially in this day and age. Another option is temporary work, non-permanent employment, for a specified period of time. So it's temporary. There's no guarantee that the job is going to continue. Maybe they're looking to fill a particular position, or it's a particular duty that company has that they need to take care of or fill for a given time. This type of option is actually good for those who want to only work part-time, a specific period of time during the year. There are some parents who say, during the school year when my kids are in school, there's after-school programs, find them, work on the full schedule. But during the summertime, I really look forward to spending time. That's a large amount of time for them to either kind of hang out at home if their the age level is appropriate, or for them to be in different types of programs, and I want to be part of that. So, some seek to change their schedules during the year for, given situations. It's also good for students who can't find permanent work. In the state agency, jobs is a good job. And, of course, non-permanent employment is also, a way to sustain ourselves. We've also got flexible scheduling. And flexible scheduling is something that any job can offer. It can be, their own idea of how to support their employees. No special requirements. This is something any job can simply say, I'm going to use this to support my employees. And so what it can be, it's any scheduling that deviates from the 9-to-5, 40-hour work week. And so flex time is one of these possibilities. It's flexible work with a fixed number of work hours. So you're going to work your 40 hours within that week, but there is openness or flexibility in the ways that you do that. So you're free to determine your work schedule. A common schedule is a 10-hour day, followed by 3 days off. Now, sometimes this flex time type of idea, it's more commonly done in certain jobs. Sometimes you see in social work, or you see in law enforcement, just by the nature of the job and the responsibilities it takes. But other companies companies are offering this thing that, you know what, I just want you to get the work done, and as long as you're able to get the work done, I don't have a problem if you need to care for your child in the morning hours until noon. And then you come in, and then you do your extended hours. You know, you do your hours for the day, just cover the job and cover your duties. It's a great way to be able to provide support for an employee and to lessen the pressure. We've also got flex place and also known as telecommuting. It's spending some or all of your work time in alternative locations. The alternate locations can be homes, satellite centers near your home. You can, with this type of situation, you can actually combine work with family responsibilities if you're physically there. You know, it doesn't substitute for childcare in any way, but it may be, because you're in the situation, it might be incompatible with your work duties. If you've got a little toddler, then you know most of your time needs to be spent on the computer, then it might not be compatible. But if you, you know, have some older children, somebody who is a child that's older or might be sick that day or might be off from school, then you're able to use this idea of telecommuting to be able to still be here with your child or your family and also to adequately get your job done. They just said that it can reduce or eliminate commuting time. Many people drive many miles to get to work, to from work every day, from traffic, extends the time it takes to be able to get to your children and pick them up, to get back home, and the day starting all over again. So it can reduce that issue. And it also makes work accessible to the developmentally disabled who might have difficulty otherwise getting back and forth to work or who might need special accommodations on the job. Different companies use this flex time to be able to support their employees. Teresa says, off topic, how do you remain calm as a social worker when you see so many bad things? Professor Squires had the same calm personality. Is this a learned trait? Wow, interesting question, Teresa. You know, part of it is, I think the reason that I was able to remain calm doing that job had to do with a lot of the support that my work environment provided. I had a really awesome environment as a social worker. And there was a management team, and a direct supervisor who said that, you know, families are a main priority. This is what we do for work, but it's also, it should remain a main priority for us. So we routinely were able to utilize things like telecommuting and this flex time because the work of a social worker, we could say that it was 9 to 5, but it really wasn't. And so if you came in at 9 and your job didn't end till, you know, 8 o'clock, what it is those extra 3 hours, instead of 8 and 9, you could come in at noon. And so that was a common occurrence, that if you work extra hours, you could come in a little bit late to compensate, or you could leave a little bit early. It really kind of free you up from the stress. Also, we had things like with the telecommuting. When I was a full-time student, I was so supported by my agency, where they would say, okay, we have classes on these days, and you're traveling very far to get to the office and to different employees' homes, get to different clients' homes. I was allowed to work from home 2 days a week, and those were the 2 days where I had classes, you know, so lots of classes in the evening. And I would get up and I would do my work, I would go out there and see my clients, and I still had enough time because I didn't have to deal with all this travel time to commute to study and then get to classes without the stress. So having a company that supports you is an awesome thing, you know. Other than that, you know, you do kind of get used to the work and you have to, you know, emotionally get yourself prepared, and a company that helps you and supports you with that is definitely, you know, one of the things that saved me. Now, different companies have different ways of supporting. The Dow Company was named 2008 Working Mother Best Company. Okay, there's a classification. You can pick 100 companies, and Dow in 2008 was in that group of the best companies. So let's see what was so individual about Dow and the support that they provided to their employees.
I'm
Best Prize that Dallas received this award from Working Mothers Magazine. Dallas took the work options are very important to balancing professional and personal life. My sick child, or my daycare provider is sick, with the help of a laptop, I can still tend to my child's needs and be productive at the same time. Every mother experiences those guilty feelings of whether she's making the right decision working. Dallas wants the work options that help me to ease the guilt of working full time. I can do a great job at work and be a great mom to my children. There are many women I know that have taken advantage of Dallas and flexible work options. In several cases, they're more productive employees as they wanted to succeed in their jobs and be successful at home. They have that determination to make it work, both the employee and Dow benefit. I've been a part of a network at Dow called the Women's Innovation Network, which is a network which focuses on the development and advancement of women. Women has provided a wonderful support network and opportunity to develop. Where else can you even have lunch with a female Fortune 500 CEO or spend time with the young Arab leaders Dell sponsoring for cultural journeys or become involved in various community activities with sites across the globe sponsor and support? As a leader of WIN, you prepare budgets, you write down my plans, and you set and execute strategies. It is a great development opportunity for transferring this skill set to Dell businesses. My advice for working mothers would be to become familiar with Dell's flexibility options. Talk with other women in your area or become involved in a WIN network. This will give you a support system to aid in your professional and personal career. On a final note, my 10-year-old daughter recently gave an A-plus grade as a full-time working mom. So this is proof Dallas' commitment to working mothers is creating a win-win for the company and the employee.
So what we're seeing is that when you are working in a supportive environment, it is not only beneficial for that company or production within that company, it's also beneficial for your family and your home life. I was just talking about my experience, and, you know, our company sometimes didn't have the amounts of money to do, provide certain other types of benefits to us, but they took what they had within their grasp to be able to support us. One of the things we had, people were looking at, people want raises and feel that support for their hard work, expense, cost of living is increasing, different things like that. They're not always financially able for smaller companies. And what our particular office decided to do was they looked to me, well, how can we utilize this? They looked at a specific amount of money that they had each month that was designated for, just costs that could possibly come up. And the idea was, I'm going to take this amount of funds, and it was $100. And he said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to award it to an employee each month for their hard work and dedication. And just a way to support, when you feel good at your job, you feel appreciated, you want to be there, you want to do a better job, you feel better about what you do there, that extends to how you interact with your family and how you are at home. We also have staff development, an average thing, staff development, you have trainings, you have to learn about certain things, and we did those. But also what our company also did was to routinely, maybe once every 6 months, sometimes we had on-site trainings, sometimes we had off-site trainings, we just need to let our head office know. There were routine times when we would have staff development, but this day was going to be at the beach. And not only was it going to be at the beach, we were going to barbecue, and you needed to bring your family. There was a time where we went to families, we went to Disneyland. There's different types of things where we were appreciated. Families were a focus and involvement, and just little things that different companies can do, whether they have the money to be able to do it, just be able to provide the support. I would take a short break and come back and continue to talk about the flexibility of telecommuting.
California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm sorry.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers an industry degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
I took one of the distance learning classes recently for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or if it didn't work out that way, David, I watched it at my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's, I'm able to watch videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center. And I would recommend this to a friend.
First, and theater second. So first, Castro will do a play reading of a
place helps in assimilating into American culture and her Asian immigrants. And in the main form, middle school or here on campus, some of our teachers, students, come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we can do like home classes and our students learn about community-based history and movement. And Tori shows all these interesting every year. We do folktale, we create a folktale drama, which is out of the sweatpaper passes. And we tour the local second grade class. So what Teatro does is really educational. It's theater that focuses on social issues. It has more of a direct purpose for society.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay Bus Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the Bus Stop representative in my store and presented the services that I can provide.
Yes, as we've opened over 4,000 applicants, we really have this. We found out that the Bus Stop really helped us find the true champion out of all the city.
I'm busy stocking how the Bus Stop provides. Not only training, but it provides a resource for the contacts. Also provides a resource for training to take some of your training pieces. So you got to offer new classes or areas of the day.
It was just a great experience. The members of the Bus Stop were always helpful in understanding
resources designed to help your business succeed. Certainly, Resource Network is here for you. Visit our website at southbayresource.net.
Bus Stop is a resource for businesses in South Bay.
This is my heresy.
Your nice paper.
Unfortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Now we've been talking about time and flex-based telecommuting, different ways that organizations and job sites can provide support to its employees and different options. Before we continue, I just want to remind you of our discussion topic today. We're asking, how does your job support you in caring for your children, your family, or just everyday life issues? You've heard some examples of some companies. I've been giving some examples of my own in terms of ways that I've been supported. You know, talk to me about ways that you've been supported on the job, whether that is through our government sponsored and mandated programs, or ways that your job has just creatively sought to support their employees and increase production and provide support for your families, and just that type of a stress reliever that can actually exist there. Now, there are some concerns about that if there's space in telecommuting some people, you are largely concerned, you know, what happens when you leave an employee without constant supervision. Okay, it can be a concern for some. Some say that it can weaken the boundaries of home and work. It can become blurred because if you are used to routinely working from home, then there are some times when you don't know when to stop, or it just simply becomes part of your everyday activity, you know, especially those of us who may constantly be on some sort of laptop putting together something or working or, you know, have that type of duty. So it is important, you know, for our own stress levels, to reduce our stress levels, to be able to designate and have specific times that are dedicated to work and also to home. So those things all you need, may need to be able to discipline themselves. You'd be surprised, you know, you think, okay, I get to work at home, there's no discipline necessary, you know, I hope I do some work. Well, no, when you look at telecommuting, because there is not that constant supervision or the additional stress or the continuous interruptions that you might find at your workplace, you do find it a more calm and serene time where you can focus and you do really get into what it is you do. Other managers find it difficult to manage their employees off-site. You know, if you are constantly having to touch bases with a manager or work on different projects, and, you know, managers say, you know, it's important if I see them, or we need to meet, we need to interact, I need to show them certain things. But, you know, with technology today, we've got a variety of ways to do that. You know, look at online courses and, you know, where it's been taken. So there are different ways and different views that people have. You know, for me, I was more motivated to do my job, first of all, you know, the trust I was given, you know, to say, okay, you know that I'm going to be home, and I'm, you know, you think I'm going to be working, you know, I actually am going to be working, I'm going to do an even better job than you would imagine, because I want to continue with this privilege, and I felt supported. And, you know, largely as a organization, what we would find is that even if you had flex days off, some employees would actually come in during lunchtime to have lunch with everybody as well, so that was interesting. Now, there are other flexible arrangements that jobs can offer. There are leaves of absence, and depending on the job, it can be paid or unpaid periods away from work. Without the job loss in terms of, you know, not losing your job or your status or even benefits. So another way that jobs can support you. Some employees can take up to 6 months to care for a child or an ill family member. That can be very beneficial. Also reduce hours during summer to maybe accommodate school vacations and different periods of time during the year. So that's also another way out of flexible arrangements. There's also leave sharing programs. I heard more and more about leave sharing. And at first, I never heard of it, and I said, wow, that just seems unheard of. Through the Employee Leave Act of 1988, employees are able to donate their sick time to other employees who have used theirs for medical leave. So you've got a coworker who is dealing with an illness, they've got a lot of appointments, or it's going to leave them incapacitated for a while. And they have used up their own sick time, their own vacation time for that purpose. And they're left without it. So the only possibility for them is to take a paid time off unless they have some good types of benefits. What this act enables people to do is to donate their sick time. You've got some sick time you've never used, or your vacation time, and you can donate it to another employee. I also, in addition to working at Cal State Davis, I was working at Cal State Long Beach, and I routinely get emails, and the subject is catastrophic leave donation. And situations that fellow employees are dealing with, it could be an illness of a family or their child or a family member, issues in terms of, you know, the military or other different types of disasters that have tragedies that have happened to them. They're needing extended time off, and these employees are able to offer some of our time to assist them. It's very common, and people continue to do it every day, and it is a great way to support your fellow employees and for a company to say, you know, it matters to us not only what happens to you here, but it matters to us what happens to you outside of who we want to provide that support. And I also want to talk about programs and services. Different programs that are available at our jobs or within the community and different services that we provide. Focusing on the issues of daycare, you know,
we'll look at programs and services around that. Now, when we look at daycare, big issue of concern on the quality. You know, what type of quality is this daycare? Are they teaching what they say they're going to teach? Are they providing adequate supervision? Is the child-to-student ratio, is the child-to-caregiver ratio appropriate? You know, is the environment safe? All of these types of quality. Also, we look at affordability. Can I pay this amount weekly or bi-weekly or monthly? You know, is this going to be something that we can do for any given period of time, let alone all year long? And when we have multiple children, added cost. I mean, daycare is a major family expense. Generally, the same society that the cost is considered a woman's expense. I think that is changing. I think families are looking at it in terms of this is the family and we need to, you know, care for our other family members and largely we figure out how we're going to do that as a family. They also say that women are not only responsible for locate, it's not only responsible for the expense, but many times they're responsible for actually locating it, making and maintaining the arrangements around daycare, and also for staying home when children are sick. If you've ever looked for a daycare or that process, you can see how tedious that process can be. You know, it's not just, okay, well, you know, we've got the period. Of course, you can Google daycare in your city, you can go with a variety of lists, but it doesn't stop there. You need to look at, you know, what's going on with that daycare. You want to go out there and visit. You want to meet the people that are working there. Sometimes you need a child there. You know, you want to take your child there to see how your child feels about the atmosphere. You know, is this going to be feasible for them? You know, you want to look at cost. You want to look at quality. You want to see if there have been any complaints from community care licensing. You want to look at a lot of things. And that's a large responsibility. Jobs and workplaces are also offering assistance. Job is a very tedious type of situation. And so some jobs have put together child care resource and referral services, specific types of services designated to work with families about securing child care. They said that 9% of workers are provided with child care resources and referrals from their job. So it's not necessarily a common type of thing, but because the necessity for child care and the stress that it does bring to work, job environments are finding it very beneficial to be able to provide some sort of resource, either a designated person or even, you know, a particular list that has been researched or the local daycares around the area. So the resources can consist of a list of licensed community child care. Some child cares have to be licensed by the state of California. Not all child cares and daycare centers either have licenses or may be current. And anybody can say, you know, this sign in front, say child daycare, or just, you know, advertise or word of mouth, they watch kids. But there are community care licensing standards and regulations that come from the state that speak to some very specific things in terms of the child to caregiver ratio, in terms of the safety level, in terms of the content of what a child is being taught or exposed to. And there are visits from the state, different types of program analysts who come out and routinely do visits and ensure that these centers are up to standard. And if they're not, they're going to find them or make sure that they have a correction plan, or they'll shut them down if, you know, they are not adhering to standards. These resources can provide education on specifically how to choose a center. What do you need to look for? What is going to be important? Or how do you pick a child care that can meet the individual needs of your child? Because maybe your child is not the typical child. Maybe your child is dealing with some sort of developmental disability. Or is a child who can be very sickly or have some other challenges. So you want to find a child that's going to be flexible, and you want to find a child care that's going to be flexible, that's going to work with you, that's going to have staff that is understanding and being able to connect with you. Now, you have on-site and near-site child centers becoming more common. But it's become even more common because in looking at studies, you have 10% of parents, so those 10% have a child care available at their job sites. And
benefits. The benefits are endless here. We're looking at less worry and anxiety from a parent, less conflict between work and family, a lead to see if the child's okay, or they've called you if something happened. There's a reduction in absenteeism if the child is close by. And there's also an increase in productivity if you don't have to deal with the stress of worrying about your child or the fact that they're close by or this is an improved daycare. I feel very blessed in the sense that with my child, she's actually being taken care of in my home by my mom and my mother-in-law. So at this point, I don't have, you know, these stress levels with this, but I do think about the fact that developmentally it's time for Ryan to, you know, to be able to interact with other children. She's going to be too something great socialization and all these great things. And so I'm starting to look into care centers and different types of programs and schools for her. And when I think about it, just thinking about it raises my level of stress. When I'm at work now, I don't think twice. She's with my mom. She's with my mother-in-law. Oh, I just call them to say hi and talk to them. Or if I don't call, there's not even a big issue. But to think of the level of stress that I do feel when I consider how am I going to concentrate? You know, how is she feeling? What's going on? They don't really know her. Or, you know, her personality. You know, all of these different things. And Jay says, what I find is that many child care services are on a sliding fee basis. Sometimes a larger income does not mean a greater flow of cash, right point. At times it seems like working and getting ahead does not pay. Yeah, it is difficult because, you know, there are times when families have to make that critical decision. You know, we feel like financially we've both got to work. But if I look at the cost of how much I'm going to be spending in daycare, if half of my check every month or more than half of my check every month is going to daycare, doesn't it make more sense for me to stay home and care for my child or to stay home and care for and work part-time? Yeah, and so sometimes these slight feels, these no-cost or low-cost, they don't necessarily work the way we had hoped. And so, you know, we're forced to look at other options. And, you know, we know that the safety and care of our children is so important to us. And how much more stressful, you know, is that when we have to look at it? What we're going to see right now is a clip that's called Kids at Work. And, you know, it's about a small business owner who, you know, felt like, you know, he's looking at his job, citing his employees and support and how he could do that and really what was going on. And he felt that, you know, providing on-site childcare was really a viable option. It was a better way to support, and it could probably increase his production and support of his employees. So let's look at Kids at Work and see what happens here.
State legislators cites childcare issues as causing more problems than any other family-related issue in the workplace, with increases in absenteeism and tardiness reported in 9 out of 10 companies. And 80% of the companies surveyed said that work days were cut short because of childcare problems. Our guest today is here to talk about on-site daycare and how that can translate into more productivity with your employees. Andrew Field founded PrintingForLess.com and quickly made it one of the nation's fastest-growing companies. His leadership has been recognized with numerous business awards, including the Winning Workplace's Best Boss Award. His company has also been recognized as one of the best on the web. Welcome, Andrew. Thank you for being here.
It's great to be here.
Now, it's my understanding that your company has the only state-licensed company childcare facility in the state of Montana. Is that correct?
We're proud to say that's true.
Why did you do that? What made you decide to offer childcare?
Well, a few years back, we had a couple very valued employees who happened to be expectant moms for the first time. And as a small company, you know how hard it is to get great people, and the last thing you want to do is lose them. And in our area, which is a very small town, only about 8,000 people, there were some good Montessori preschools, but they usually only started about 3 years old. So for that gap between when a mom first comes back to work at 8 or 12 weeks or whatever it is, and 3 years, there really weren't a lot of good options. And we started our child care program on site so that our parents wouldn't have to choose between either being good parents or continuing with a good career.
Well, I guess, too, for new moms, it's always nice to know that your child is so nearby. It makes going back to work a lot easier, I imagine.
I think it does. There's always that letting go stress and that sort of thing if the kid's crying the first day. But the fact that moms and dads, for that matter, can go up and visit their kids anytime throughout the day is really a nice thing. And I think it gives them a little more focus on their work during their day, knowing that if something goes wrong, they're only a few steps away.
What are some of the other benefits of offering child care to you as a company owner?
I think it's been a focus, and it gives people the opportunity to continue their careers, not have to interrupt them and relearn and retrain. Here's another thing. Even for prospective employees who won't utilize it, maybe they don't have children of that age or something like that, it says something about who we are and about the family values that our company represents, and I know for a fact that it's helped us to recruit some really great people.
You know, one of the things a lot of small businesses say to me that when they think about having on-site child care is they worry about the liability and the risk. How did you mediate that when you decided to do this with your company?
Well, one of the things we did was we are state licensed. We get regular inspections and surprise inspections. We obviously buy the appropriate insurance, and every single one of our providers has the right certifications and that sort of thing. And we just try to do the same thing we do in every other area of the company, which is hire great people. Another thing is that we're not, you know, remote, and we're right there, and the child care facility is right near the entrance, so it's pretty visible and out there in the open, and it gets a fair amount of visitors as well.
Yeah, that's great. Do you have any tips for someone in our audience who's watching that they might want to open an on-site child care facility?
I'd say if you can, partner with somebody who already knows how to do it. That option wasn't available to us, even though we tried. But if you can partner with someone who's already an expert, that's great. If not, you'll need to hire somebody, particularly as the director position, who has experience doing it. You don't want to reinvent this wheel from scratch.
What about if they want to go and research this and what their options are and find these people that you're talking about? Is there someplace that they could go to begin that research?
In most states, and I think even nationally, there are organizations that specialize in helping people get child care programs going. So just look around on the web and find one near you.
Thank goodness for the internet, right? Well, thank you for being here, Andrew. We appreciate you sharing that story with us.
My pleasure.
Andrew Field.
There is a good point in saying that you shouldn't have to choose between being a good parent and your career. You know, so hopefully, you know, more organizations and companies are looking at this and saying, you know, the more we support our families, the better off they are as people, the better off they are as people within our jobs, and the more productivity that can actually exist, and it's a better society. Now, one of the things when we look at child care, we know that child care don't accept sick children. They can't. Licensing regulations say you can't have sick children around other children because they can expose them to illnesses. And that's a whole other problem. So some people say that, you know, these types of, well, you know, daycare period, you know, it may have a little effect on absenteeism because there are some situations that simply make it a situation where you have to find alternative types of care, or that you're simply going to have to say, you know what, I'm going to have to stay home, or my husband's going to have to stay home today because my child is sick. We've also got some options for children who might be ill, or if you need some sort of emergency care. So some centers offer care for them. They offer care for children who are ill. Sometimes this care can be given at local hospitals or facilities that specifically care for sick children. So it's good to know because there are some children who are chronically ill. They may be dealing with other types of illnesses, which can temporarily make them incapacitated to be in the general population, or their child is dealing with some ongoing health challenges. And so it's good to know that there are some facilities that are actually caring for sick children, so it's not as though, well, this is the situation my child is dealing with, so I need to just say, you know, I can work, and I need to stay home and care for my child. Also, some other arrangements with private or non-private nursing homes to care for the kids. And we've also got child care consortium with other employees. And so what happens is there are several employers that are sharing expenses of opening and maintaining the child care center. So that individually the employer can't do it on their own, but so they partner up with some other organizations. Partnering organizations or organizations within the community, and they say, we're going to put together and open up this child care center to support our employees.
It's better for companies without enough money to be able to open up their own center. And it's definitely great resources. And you know, to be able to sustain the center by saying that here we've got another company who's assisting with the care and maintenance of that center. Now, if we look at continue to look at programs and services, the things that our jobs are providing, we've got some jobs that are providing some specific tools for peers, maybe PRT seminars or education, and also support. So what we have is a set of services that maybe HR is providing, and these can be offered during work time, after work time, you know, during lunchtime, what they may call lunchtime seminars on a variety of different topics such as family life, education, parenting, balancing work and family, coping with children's issues, effective discipline. They can provide resource materials. Maybe there's not a specific class, but they have resource materials, books, videos, some sort of lending library. And sometimes there are specific programs and departments that are designated to provide employees with these types of resources. Largely, what we have are EAPs, employee assistance programs through a variety of employers. What they do is they cover a range of services for employees. They can provide anything from psychologists, social workers, attorneys, counselors, resources, confidential services for state and California employees, a variety of different types of services that are specifically to provide employee assistance. So let's take a look at the employee assistance program and look at what some of these specific benefits are.
You are entitled to Employee Assistance Program, or EAP, benefits. EAP is brought to you by Managed Health Network, or MHN, which has been providing EAP services for more than 20 years. In this video, we will tell you exactly what EAP is and how you can most effectively use it. The EAP covers a broad range of services that are provided by highly trained and certified specialists, such as psychologists, social workers, financial counselors, and licensed attorneys. EAP services are always confidential. You can access EAP by a toll-free telephone number or going to our website. This makes EAP services very easy to use. EAP is a free, voluntary program paid for by the state of California for its employees. EAP services are strictly confidential and governed by state and federal law. No reports are made to the employer except aggregate utilization reports that don't identify individuals. And no reports are made to supervisors without the employee's written consent. The legal exceptions to confidentiality are the same as those that guide all clinicians. If a member expresses a possible suicidal or homicidal intent, or the intent to commit child or elder abuse, then the clinician is bound by law to notify authorities. Additionally, if the clinician receives a court order or subpoena requiring him or her to reveal otherwise confidential information, the clinician must comply.
Those eligible for EAP include all active state employees, their lawful spouse, and unmarried dependent children. Dependent children are natural, adopted, or stepchildren under age 23. However, if a child is incapable of self-sustaining employment due to mental or physical disability, he or she is considered a dependent at any age. Beginning January 1st, 2005, registered domestic workers will also be eligible for EAP. Dependent children in the military are not eligible. The state of California has three employment categories and three different benefit designs. It is important to know which category you are in so you receive the appropriate benefit. Please review your benefit flyer or contact your EAP coordinator if you have questions about your benefit level. Employment category benefit level 1 includes employees in bargaining units 5 and 7 and all exempt managerial, supervisory, and confidential employees of the California Highway Patrol. Employees, managers, supervisors, and confidential employees in bargaining units 6, 7, and 8, and seasonal and intermittent firefighters. This group gets 7 clinical counseling sessions per problem type per year for both employee and spouse individually. Dependent children and the family may share 7 clinical counseling sessions per problem type per year. Employment category and benefit level 2 includes all CHP I previously mentioned, specifically forestry and fire protection, Department of Corrections, Board of Prison Terms, Prison Industry Authority, the Youth Authority, Youth Offender Parole Board, and the Youth and Adult Correctional Agency. This group is entitled to 3 sessions per problem type. Total shared between the employee, spouse, and dependent children. Employment category in level 3 is for all other State of California employees. This group receives 3 sessions total for the employee and 3 sessions total for the spouse and dependent children combined. As I mentioned, some benefit levels get a specific number of visits per problem type. There are 4 problem types for clinical services. They are substance abuse, alcohol abuse, marital and family issues, and emotional and personal stress.
Many employees may not want or need clinical counseling, but could use some help with daily life issues. To meet these needs, EAP offers work and life services, which include legal financial consultation, child and elder care consultation, and more. Keep in mind that these services do not count towards your per problem type sessions.
So looking at employee assistance programs with the different types of benefits was really interesting for me as I was preparing for this. It started me to really begin to think, you know, when we talk about balancing work and family, besides working here, I work at 3 other colleges. But so it really caused me to figure out how I'm going to balance everything. And as I started to research for this, I said, you know what, all the colleges I work at, I wonder if all the different types of services are the same. Maybe I can do a little compare and contrast and see what they provide. So I started to really look more in depth at employee assistance services. And I looked at Cal State University Dominguez Hills and the employee benefits and assistance that they provide. And what I found is that CSUD uses Horizon Behavioral Services to really provide a company that is providing that large umbrella of services for them. And they provide a different type of lots of different categories and areas. And so what happens here is that there are different components when it comes to Horizon's behavioral services and what they provide. Just an example, so we've got a toll-free number, 24-hour, 365-day telephonic assessment and triage when needed, unlimited telephone consultation and assessment. There are face-to-face counseling sessions, legal and financial consultation, policy consultation, and this is just a few workplace training seminars that they provide, access in response to dramatic events that employees or the college itself might be dealing with. They categorize different areas. They talk about work-life services. When we talk about work-life services, a variety of issues that can lead to stress there, and these things include things like child care, elder care, pet care, adoption, education, daily support services. We've also got another category of legal and financial consultation services, issues of separation and divorce, child support payments, general tax or investment questions, people that are dealing with issues with collection agencies, retirement funds, rollover if you're dealing with that, automobile accidents, serious traffic accidents, elder care, will preparation, defective merchandise, I have no idea. They also offer management and consultation and referral, so they offer services to managers around the clock, you know, say if there's a particular issue, situation going on, a manager can contact them and say, look, this is what's going on, I need some support, how do I handle it? We have got management services, unlimited on-demand supervisor consultation, supervisor training, even if they're triggered interventions. Say, for example, a company that might be dealing with mergers or downsizing or traumas. And they talk about some facts. You know, when you ask yourself the question, how is utilizing the services, how does it benefit you to utilize the services, you know, as an organization? And they really say it's an opportunity for return on your investment. They say they quote 44% reduction in absenteeism, 35% reduction in substance abuse and health care costs, 30% lower employee turnover rate, and a reduction in the amount of days lost due to disability and lower incident of long-term disability. And really interesting, just a variety of different types of leave. We have got sick leave, CSU, family sick, family medical leave, California pregnancy, disability, maternity, maternity, paternity, educational leave. industrial disability leave, catastrophic bereavement, it goes on and on and on. So it's really interesting how many of us in the work somewhere and we truly don't even know what our organization actually provides to support us. How many of us have dealt with some of the situations I've just mentioned and didn't even know that your organization could possibly provide you some sort of support behind it. So really interesting. It's really interesting, very valuable for me to actually have to do this research to look at it. Also, when we look at programs and services, and looking at the programs and services that employers have elected to provide, generally we really want the services that a company provides to reflect the needs of our workers. It's really important. You know, in something like breastfeeding, we've got some organizations who are providing breastfeeding support, setting aside a specific room. Things like dry cleaning, take home dinners, car servicing. There's no end to what companies are really doing today on a large and in a small level. Let's take a look at Google. We've all heard of Google, but have you ever really thought about, well, hey, what if I work for Google? What type of support could I receive from them? Let's take a look at work in Google.
Well, there's one place where people are knocking down the doors to get a job. Today, Fortune magazine names the 100 best companies to work for in America, and NBC's John Larson is standing by at the New York office of the company that is at the top of the list. John, good morning to you.
Good morning to you, Matt. One of the things that's been so much fun about this particular story is that the reason this company is number one, one of many reasons that people are having so much fun here. This is the game room where they come down and play video games. They're a little pool hall during the course of the day if they want to. Now, if you missed the name of the company when we were teasing it before, the brand new name here. They've been in the news a lot this year with record profits, huge acquisitions. Many people know their name. The name of the company has now become its own verb in the dictionary. So while you're thinking about that, I'll show you why Fortune magazine thinks that this company is the killer place to work in America. First off, let's talk to
we have a stuffed fries, a small boring, gluten-free sausage.
Imagine opening the four main restaurants in your office.
We serve rack of lamb all the time.
And all the food is free.
That's right. Have it.
Now imagine a free fitness center.
Come on.
Yeah. A barber shop close to you. Car wash is close to work. Pool tables in your office, black pools for exercise, volleyball courts, and naturally, company massages. Is that like vacation?
No, it's definitely not vacation, but it's a feeding matrix tour.
Want to buy a migrant? This company will give you $5,000 to do it. Want to wear your jammies to work? No problem. Got a cold? There are five doctors on site, and they are all free.
This culture of appreciating your environment, your fellow human being, how it should be in utopia.
Utopia may be a bit strong, but after studying hundreds of American companies, Fortune magazine this morning is announcing that Google is America's best company to work for. That's right, Google. All these firms are the product of the search engine giant based in Mountain View, California. This is the most engaging, insanely great work environment in corporate America. I mean, it was the massage stations, the couches, the wacky behavior. You know, people are truly having a great time working here. And what does Google get in return? Employees with tremendous job loyalty and productivity.
These are geared towards staying focused on the improvement and actually building a great
company. Work through the night if necessary, and who tell us they have never had more fun. They're now the vice president of legal operations. That's okay.
Seems like you can hear ways of having.
Seriously, it looks like a problem. You're way too happy. I want to see more frowns around here.
Yeah, if that's a problem, I hope I thought it's a problem.
If there's a problem, it's success. Despite all these expensive firms, the company is posting record profits with huge margins and growing so fast that keeping this intimate culture will be a challenge.
company receives about 3,000 applications a day. That's about $1 million a year, while chasing about 4,000 jobs. Jobs with drop-dead perks. Employers, as they call themselves, can bring their pets to work as long as their co-workers don't mind pets or any reason. That's better.
It's nice to be able to share a little bit of your life with your co-workers.
You know, the company's founders wake up one day and realize their employees are having too much fun with these two clowning around in their silver tapes. Okay, those are Google's founders, millionaires Larry Page and Sergey Brin. That's one of the core philosophies of that company. It comes from the hierarchy's bad, the morale of the teams are bad, and the opposite of that's good. Meaning small, creative teams, highly flexible, and so motivated.
I'm a photographer. I'm going to take your picture from a helicopter about 500 feet above you.
Their Googlers are happy to do almost anything for their company, including standing out in the rain for the Fortune magazine photo shoot. Can you do this? I'm so glad you're doing the company. It's a kind of a jump. No, I'm just kidding. You guys should get it again. I'm very happy for you. Anyone who wants to do get jobs at Google and tell us it is easy to love this company and not difficult to keep a straight face.
This is the phenomenal upgrade from the last employer.
I love my job.
I have more time here than I do the best I ever did. Wait, don't go ahead.
The issue comes out in about 8 weeks. The runner-up was Genentech. Whole Foods is also in their container store, and just a lot of great companies. I thought we had a good year at GE and BC. I may have to pull up Norma Ray and have some kind of employee meeting after all this. Sorry, Nick, exactly. I'll use you as a reference. Yeah. John Larson, thank you very much. So, and we're going to take you down to Q.
So can a company really have it all? Can it really provide everything that an employee needs to be able to support them on the job and off the job? So is this chaos or is this a workplace? And, really interesting to look at how society and society stress can motivate people to say, oh, I want to support my people in any way I can to be able to reduce absenteeism, to have a sense of togetherness and teamwork, to be able to make sure that they're not spending the vast majority of their day worried about what's going on at home. So, interesting title. So, as everybody finishes, it's been all on Google and applied. Well, 3,000 people a year, besides I was already on the website last night. Anyway, we've also got policies. Companies have policies, they have formal written policies. And basically, what that is, these are formal written policies confirming the families, confirming the organization's commitment to families. And more often, we're seeing these posted in prominent places. And companies say that we are a family company, we provide that different type of support to people to be able to support them in doing their jobs. Now, I also want to quickly mention our discussion board. Now, your discussion board, of course, number one is due at midnight. You got to view, can you afford to retire? You got to respond to who should be responsible for planning retirement. And you're also going to answer the question, what roles should individuals, businesses, and government play in the planning of retirement? So focus on this, continue to work on your other discussion boards and assignments. And we will see you next week.